Wildfire, an imprint of Headline Publishing Group Limited, presents The Black Dog by Kevin Bridges, read by Angus Kidd. Part 1.
It's Sharm el Sheikh, Ryan. Sharm el Sheikh. Sheikh, like a milkshake, not Sharm el Sheikh.
She's got a big grin on and looking round the living room, making sure they're all laughing, making sure every cunt is laughing. Every cunt. I've went that nauseous, light-headed way. The room's spinning and their faces go all blurred and distorted, pixelated to fuck, like when you watch the Fitbot wee steesh for the worksuits. The rage is overwhelming. Over-fucking-whelming. The rage that you only get when your bird corrects you in front of everybody. I can just about make out her face. Then the two sisters, the wee brother and his new bird. The granny's there too. And then there's the wank of a da, pouring his wee can of Holston pills, or whatever piss he's drinking now, into his glass and looking up, laughing, oh chuffed. He's having a fucking great wee night. Sniggering away, a right wee shitey laugh, eh? His face doesn't suit it. Like one of the cunts that doesn't deserve to laugh.
Sharm el Sheikh,
he's repeating, sitting admiring the froth in his daft tumbler.
Sharm el Sheikh up, yeah, yeah.
Her granda's got up off his chair now. What the fuck? He's up on his feet, trying to dance, making out that he's Elvis.
80 years old, and he's sharp as a tack. Oh, happy birthday, granda.
Her sister's hitting out way, and then putting a big kiss on his cheek. All the voices are slowing down, muffled. I can't make out words, just noise. Distorted. It's like I'm underwater or something, chucked into the Clyde, and every single cunt that's ever put me down is there. Every cunt that's ever had a go at me, they're all there, pointing, laughing, pissing themselves at who I have become. My eyelids are flickering, sweat pissing off me. My head's went cloudy and I can't think. It's like I'm floating. Maybe this is one of the out-of-body experiences like the American cunts on YouTube that we steesh is always on about.
Get yourself together, Rizo. Screw the nut, I say to myself, like a football manager watching his side about to capitulate under an early onslaught of pressure.
Where will you be staying, Ryan? The Heartbreak Hotel?
The old cunt's just out with. Not a bad bit of patter. I'll give him that.
They're all fucking roaring, Buttman. Cunts are hodding their sights, greeting, tears, horns in the air like they're tapping out. Holston pills running down the da's nose.
Here, you're tacking it tight, Rizo. Surprised at you, mate. Surprised you're letting yourself get took for a cunt here. I'm saying to myself. Fucking settle down, Rizo. Settle. And fae nowhere, I'm back in the room. My fight or flight receptors have kicked in, or whatever the hing wee steesh is always saying. The old cunt's dancing about, the life and soul. I just fucking fly for him. Bang! You cunt. That wee split second that done it for us. The wee split second I seen it in his eyes. Seen it register that it was fucking Rizo he was winding up. Goading. I land a heavy blow. Cunt flies right back to where he came fae, into his chair, but his chair can't take the impact because of the pace I've set him travelling. The women are screaming, especially her, delighted she's got something else to get on my case about. The wee brother jumps up off the couch. Wee cunt thinks he's a ticket, stays up to watch the cage fighting. Doesn't eat breed and all that. He's coming right for me, fast, wiry wee cunt, fast, but no fast enough. Fuck you! Walking stick right off the face. Bang! I'm standing there like Bruce fucking Lee. Enter the dragon. Enter the fucking Rizo. I'm egging myself on for inside my own head whilst they're all trying to pick the chair up with the old cunt still in it. Spurt clean out.
Watch his hip! Watch his hip!
Her sister's screaming.
Fuck his hip! Tell him to watch his mouth.
I lean over the toppled chair and get right in his face.
Watch your fucking mouth!
I look about the room, every cunt greeting. Different mood now, eh? A great fucking time when it was, let's all rip the piss out of Rizo, though. I decide it's best that I make my excuses and leave, because you will not hear the end of this one. The wee man's in the living room now, wanting to know what's going on. I gave him a wee pat on the head.
Your old papa was being a bully, son, but daddy sorted it. Way back in play, pal.
I want to let him know the old cunt hasn't got long left and then we'll all get weighed in. But I show some decorum and keep that to myself. The wee man looks at us going,
are we still going on an aeroplane to Egypt?
Fucking heartbreaking.
I don't think we will be now, pal. No anymore. Mummy's no gonna let us.
He looks at her as if,
what the fuck's that all about then?
The wee man knows I love him, and that I would do anything for him. Got his name tattooed down my neck, the lot. More than can be said for her. Obsessed with getting him into all the Disney pish.
If I don't go to bed, Mummy will turn into a pumpkin, Daddy.
He was geeing it the other night.
If you don't go to bed, the cunts that leather your Uncle Barry will slap you about and all, I said.
See, I'm a realist. I teach him about real life, no fantasy. I do like Cinderella, though, I will admit. Especially the wee fat moose cunt, Gus, I think.
I nod to the wee man and stick my jacket on. I get outside the house and I phone wee Steesh and head down the boozer to get him. He's sitting with a couple of cunts fade doing his bit. They're full of shite. Daft cunts, no the brightest. Any motorsports and all that, but fuck it. I sink a couple of jars and there I am, back, hard in court, telling every cunt the story.
False teeth flying across the living room, then the dog was off with him.
You need to add a wee bit of an artistic license. That's what makes me who I am. A good laugh. A cracking cunt.
They're all pishing themselves. There's some gear going about now, so we're all in the kludgy. Me, Steesh, and two other cunts, racking them up.
What a laugh, Rizo. Some fucking boy. Mind that night, you?
I come bouncing out the bog, thinking how I like wee Steesh. Always pays a tribute to, as a real pal. See, that's my idea of a night out. A right good swally and every cunt telling Rizo stories. Fae fucking nowhere, but I just burst out into tears. Fucking greeting. They're all going,
what's wrong, Rizo?
Wee Steesh tries to give me a cuddle kind of thing. I'm tempted to nut the cunt, but before you know it, I'm down on my knees. I get my phone out. I cut across the pub on my fucking knees. Every cunt staring. I get to the bit where you get a signal and I phone her. Before she can lecture us, I'm away, putting a few things straight. Sham el Sheikh! Sham el Sheikh! I'm screaming down the line. Fucking, fuck your Sham el Sheikh! Ah! I feel numb. I feel nothing bar my own piss running down my leg. Can't I stop greeting? Greeting and pissing myself on the fucking boozer. This is the end. I'm done with it all. I walk out into the street. I hear wee Steesh and a few other cunts shouting me back, but it's done now. It's all over we. Goodbye, you cunts, and fuck yous. Every one of yous.
Declan knew he'd misread the room. He'd honed a heightened sense of self-awareness over the years, a personal transferable skill acquired through an abundance of similar humiliations, from primary school to high school and college to the group interview which had denied him a job at Asda. Their loss, Morrison's gain though. He'd held his shelf-stacking job for close to 3 years, which was a relative success, it could be argued. But Declan had served his apprenticeship in failure, and he knew exactly when he had fucked up again. After his solo performance of an original spoken word piece, he had remained standing. He knew that sitting down would be a signal for the feedback to commence, and no one was ready for that yet. His gaze was fixed slightly above the heads of his seated audience. He knew not to look down, to allow them at least a few seconds of privacy to adjust to the change in atmosphere. The audience reciprocated this reverence, and no one looked up at Declan. But he could sense the sets of eyes below him, looking around to make contact with each other, to confirm the tension. Relative strangers in the class were bonding through the awkwardness, like the big rugby player type guy Ross, who'd been coming to the class with a view of getting into acting, and a girl called Lauren, or maybe Laura. She'd corrected Declan on the second week, and he was since reluctant to take the 50-50 gamble and commit to a direct addressal, who both nodded an embarrassed apology at Declan after her high-pitched cackle perforated the ephemeral yet excruciating stillness that his recital had sprung on the class. Their contrite faces acknowledged their minor betrayal of Declan as, being the three youngest and all non-smokers, they'd been exchanging small talk during the brief break in the two-hour classes over the past few weeks. The conversations hadn't progressed from the superficial drama, documentary and film recommendations, assumed shared ground given the theme of the class, and some fatigued commentary on current global affairs, opinion free of course. Any slight deviation from the neutral was halted by generic, "the world's gone mad," or the ubiquitous post-COVID, "it's all a bit 1984. The latter, often accompanied by the quick, self-satisfied glance of someone who seized on a relevant moment to reference a book they've never read. Their exchanges were fairly rigid, but they served a purpose in passing 10 minutes without any lulls and with minimal screen time. If they'd clicked more and reached the point that they could take the piss out of each other, then maybe the blatant mockery of Declan and his performance wouldn't have seemed as deceitful. It wasn't clear what Ross had done to elicit such a piercing laugh, but during the first week introductions, he'd confidently told the class that he often entertained his workmates and that they loved his facial expressions and compared him to Jim Carrey. He tried to showcase a couple of his favourites and do a few impressions during class exercises. He wasn't very good, although it didn't discourage him. You got people like that, Declan knew. People with unwavering self-assurance, built upon zero merit. A personal, transferable skill acquired through years of having never been punched in the face. "Come on now, Lauren. It's not an easy thing." Alex, the tutor, brought the focus from a mortified-looking Lauren back to Declan's car crash of a performance and its ill-judged content. "Lauren. Lauren. Lauren. Ralph. Lauren." Declan's memorising of her name was futile, as he knew he'd probably never see her again. This was his last week of coming to the class, he vowed. His dad had seen the advert in the arts-type pullout of a Sunday newspaper and mentioned it to his mum, and they'd paid for the writing and performing for pleasure and profit course as a Christmas present to their firstborn, who'd long been interested in writing, television and film. The guilt he would feel from abandoning it a little over halfway would serve as a strong argument for his return, but for now, the liberating thought of walking out of the Arts Centre door and never having to see these people again alleviated his dread of the looming group discussion on his work. Lauren looked genuinely remorseful and ashamed, and even though she had laughed at him, Declan felt bad for her. This was his fault. What was he doing coming here? Tuesday nights in an Arts Centre? 2 fucking buses? It was a bastard to get to. The blanket term for anywhere without direct transport links from one's front door. 2 buses and a fairly challenging walk, gradually uphill and about a half mile or so. Not the type of terrain or the distance that would ever raise funds for a charitable cause, but demanding enough to leave Declan self-conscious about his arse marking a visible equator of perspiration on the centre's dark grey plastic seats. Lauren and the rest of the class had probably all been to university. Some of them even had writing and acting credits, Declan remembered, from the opening night's initial meet-greet. He hadn't heard of any of the publications or productions that were mentioned, but he'd managed to look impressed enough as the CVs were rattled off. This wasn't his world. This was their world.
I found it a little, I don't know, toxic? One for the lads, maybe.
The voice sounded like a head teacher, a senior police officer, a Scottish Conservative politician. It was that sort of voice and that sort of tone. A voice and tone incompatible with saying anything positive to someone like Declan. The story hadn't gone down well. Fair enough. Leave it there, Declan thought, hoping to switch off before being offered some constructive criticism. The worst fucking kind, he thought. And this dose sounded certain to be administered with the self-satisfied smugness of someone convinced that they are the most interesting person in the room, and that they've observed what no one else has, like they're breaking an exclusive, like it hadn't already crossed Declan's mind that he had fucked up quite catastrophically. Declan wasn't from a background where criticism was a means of constructing anything. Its purpose was to hurt, to ridicule. It was a power tool used to alleviate one's own insecurities and failings by emphasising, and often exaggerating, those of the subject. Constructive criticism had blighted his life for as long as he could remember. He loved football, but constructive criticism had led to his early retirement from the game at the age of 12. A heavy touch in his own penalty box resulted in his team's early exit from a mini-European Championships tournament held as part of the end-of-term activities in his first year at high school.
Fucking shite, you useless fat bastard!
The voice of an exasperated Scott Lawson echoed in his head as he'd replayed the goal. That Scott Lawson was said to be a drug addict now, currently serving a custodial sentence for attempting to rob an Esso garage, armed with a Stanley blade, didn't offer any satisfaction. Declan had long dropped any charges. He had said worse to himself, and he knew that Scott Lawson had been correct, and, in a way, Declan appreciated his honesty. It had caused him to stop embarrassing himself on a football pitch, and to try and watch what he was eating, at least in the weeks that followed. It had been more bullying than constructive criticism, perhaps. But that was at an age when a bit of bullying, in moderation, could be beneficial for your development. Not now, though. Not now that Declan was his own biggest bully and any criticism, constructive or scathing, only served as a fortification, holding him captive in his own head. Declan realised his mind had gone elsewhere. Like he had trained it to do when he felt under attack, when his heart rate would speed up and that feeling in his stomach came back, the feeling that had a superpower to transport him back to any other stage in his life when he'd felt similarly feeble and useless. At 24, he'd familiarised himself with the assembly points to get to during these episodes, which anything he perceived as a confrontation could bring on. The safe houses in his head where he could try and get comfortable and drift off to his own hard luck story. A supermarket worker, brought up and still living in a low-income household, sleepwalking through a second crack at completing an HNC at an underfunded college in a neglected building on the outskirts of the city centre. What chance have you got in a room of artistic, middle-class creatives? These thespians, these wankers. It would always take this course, the voice in his head. It would lure Declan in by consoling him and reminding him of how he was up against it, of all the obstacles in his path. He'd recently picked up the potentially destructive habit of letting this inner monologue dictate to him, unchallenged. It would turn nasty. Everyone would be called a prick. Life itself would be deemed meaningless. And then it would get to its favourite subject of Declan himself. He was fat. Ugly.
He'd no real qualifications, no trade, no career prospects. He'd never get a girlfriend. The voice would be off on one, like a United States Marine sergeant mercilessly reprimanding the tenant of an unmade bed. Declan jolted himself back into the room, noticing that he was still standing as more of the group were contributing to the conversation about Rizo and the disturbing themes that had been addressed. Some found positives, most found flaws, some found it offensive, but it didn't matter now. The confidence and the conviction that had carried Declan to the end of his performance had abandoned him. And whoever that self-assured, flamboyant showman that had stood up and taken centre stage for those 5 or 6 minutes was, had bailed. Fucked off, leaving the real Declan to deal with the debris. He'd felt like someone else for a while. He hadn't quite managed to immerse himself in the character, or whatever. But he had felt like he was acting, at least. He'd thought about it all day at college, on the bus there, the bus home, and on both buses here. He'd never spoken in front of an audience before, let alone performed, and let alone performed his own work. He'd been in negotiations with his nerves all day. Everyone else is going to have to do it. Face your fears. What's the worst that can happen? All those adages had culminated in him printing off one of his short stories in his college library, writing he'd never shown anyone, and presenting it to his class. He went over his performance in his head. The tones, the intonations. He'd really tried to sell it. He had attacked it with a fervour, like someone with rock-solid belief in their material, which made him cringe even more. Even if he'd narrated it in a monotone drawl, like Rugby Ross had done, he wouldn't have left himself so open, so exposed, he thought, as he felt his arms folding. Defensive body language, he remembered someone telling him. His hands nestled under his armpits, which were soaked. He glanced down to see the sweat patches that had appeared on his dark grey round-neck jumper. He'd sweated through many a t-shirt and his work polo shirt, but a jumper was a first. It wasn't the satisfying sweat of physical exertion or honest labour either. This was the unique, special blend the human body distills exclusively for occasions when one makes a colossal cunt of oneself. Declan felt a second wave of mortification come over him, as he imagined if any of his pals had been present to witness whatever the fuck he'd just done, that they'd probably be in the pub watching one of the Champions League games made him think of the safety of the familiar surroundings, the same faces and the conversations that would only be as intellectual as he made them. There had been confirmed sightings of Declan reading a book, so he was regarded as a savant in his social circle. He felt a pang, like homesickness. He was only maybe 7 or 8 miles from where he grew up, from the only house that he'd ever lived in. But he felt like he was in a distant land, the hostile unknown. He felt like he'd volunteered to fight in an unwinnable war and found himself taken hostage. He glanced to his left at Rugby Ross's watch and saw that there was a quarter of an hour left of the class. He started to think of the outside and his plans for his release whilst words like derivative, vulgar, crude, and terms like toxic masculinity were being fired around the room. It would be about 15 quid in an Uber, he remembered from the previous week, when he'd considered getting one but decided to keep the money and take the soaking. This was different, though. He just wanted his old life back. So the price of the convenience was justifiable, even if it more or less equated to working the first 2 hours of tomorrow afternoon shift for free. He had his exit plan in place, and thought of the commiserating feeling that the first drink of a cold pint would provide, and of ditching the strange speaking voice that he'd unconsciously developed. Again, he felt himself squirm as he thought of his pals. Where could he tell them he'd been? He couldn't dare mention that he'd been attending this sort of thing. He'd even sought an assurance of confidentiality from his own parents and his younger sister, Chiara. Writing was the only thing that he'd ever felt mildly competent at, and he wanted to study it more to develop and see if it could take him anywhere, even if he didn't have one single word published. He knew he was at his happiest writing, when he could disappear over the hills behind the new-built houses to the back of his street, with just his music, his notebook and Hector, his 7-year-old black Labrador cross. That's why he was here. He'd got this one wrong. But he wasn't a performer. That didn't interest him. Maybe if he'd printed individual copies of his original spoken word piece and handed them out to be read, the class would have taken more from it. Not that there was much to take. But Rizzo was an interesting enough character. A composite of the sociopathic, deeply flawed lunatics Declan had met in his short life. His hometown was full of guys like Rizzo, and the poor women who feel stuck with and imprisoned by them. A writing and performing for pleasure and profit class in an art centre wasn't the correct demographic for Rizzo, he accepted. It wasn't their fault they didn't like it. He'd brought a bare-knuckle brawl to a centre court Wimbledon crowd. Ultimately, it had been meant to be a comedy piece, as dark as it was. Declan only intended to draw a few laughs from the deranged world of young adult male insecurity and the perceived injustices felt by those being forced to grow up and enter the real world against their will. He tried to make some semblance of a point too. But what that was, he didn't quite know himself.
What is it that they say? We learn from failure, not from success.
Declan felt Rugby Ross's hand slapping his knee. Alex, the tutor, looked at Declan with a smile and nodded at Ross's quote, as though to confirm that yes, he was correct. They did say that. It was patronising, but nothing to be taken personally, and at least the class was about to move on, and the last couple of speakers were to get up. Declan felt a bit of confidence come back to him. And before he could tell himself just to let it go, he was challenging Ross.
A great quote. And do you know who said it?
He was surprised to stumble upon a trace of defiance that had lain dormant inside of him as the firing squad took shots at his work. He realised these were the first words he'd spoken since Rizzo signed off with a
"Fuck yous, every one of yous."
Oh, I think it's just a general thing. It would be hard to credit it to anyone in particular.
Ross looked round at the faces of everyone else in the group, except Declan's, as he answered his question, as though Declan's performance hadn't been enough to affirm that it was them against him.
You see it on Instagram a lot,
he added, turning to Lauren for verification.
Bram Stoker, mate. Professor Abraham Van Helsing. And Dracula. He said it.
Declan felt a round of applause break out in his head and rare shouts of encouragement. He'd got himself back in the game.
Fucking superb, son!
It had come from nowhere. He'd stood his ground and salvaged something from the evening.
I've literally just finished reading Dracula. That is so weird. I take it you've read it. It's actually so good.
Lauren quickly put her hand over her mouth and turned to Alex, her face apologising for her excited digression. Declan smiled and, unfolding his arms, he leaned forward and pulled his seat a few inches further into the shape of the class and waited for Alex to call forward the next turn. He looked at Ross's watch again. The traffic wouldn't be bad, so he'd probably make it to the pub for around 9:30, he calculated, whilst a poem was being recited. He didn't have college the next day, and his shift wasn't until 1 p.m. Doof Doof had Wednesday off, so no doubt he'd be in the pub and a few pints in by now. Declan had stopped in to buy a bottle of Coke from the co-op on the walk here, partly to kill time, so as not to arrive at the art centre early, a lesson learned from the week before, when he'd had to stand trying to take part in conversation with two of the senior class members as they reminisced about time spent in New York and London,
on Broadway and in the West End.
He could go back to the co-op,
buy a quarter bottle of vodka and pour some into his half-empty Coke bottle. He'd buy another bottle of Coke to top it up with and replace the missing Coke from the new bottle with the rest of the vodka. Perfect. It was the sort of mixology he'd mastered from when he used to go to the football, on the supporters' bus. It would pass the Uber journey, and also help cut the inebriation deficit on anyone who'd been in the pub since 7. If anyone had asked where he'd been, he could say he'd gone out for a drink with a few people from his college class, an alibi that the effects from the rapidly consumed quarter bottle of vodka would corroborate. His plans were sealed, just as the poem came to a sudden theatrical end, and Helen, the retired GP, was thanking the group for listening and explaining how much the words had meant to her. After Alex praised Helen's work and prompted the rest of the class to come forth with their analyses and their interpretations and all of that, he began wrapping up the class and thanking everyone for coming. Declan managed to restrain himself from leaping up with too much enthusiasm, but it was like the school bell had rung in a Friday afternoon. He stretched his shoulders back as he stood up from his seat, cautiously checking back for any streaks of sweat, and folded his sheets of A4 paper over, the word "every cunt" catching his eye a couple of times, which made him writhe with shame as he glanced round at his class again, watching them pack away their pucker pads and their moleskin notebooks into their tote bags and satchels. He picked up his Coca-Cola bottle from under the chair, checking that the lid was tightened, and then he crushed Rizo into the back pocket of his jeans whilst looking at the bin across the room, on the opposite side of the door that Ross and Lauren were leading the class out of. He wanted to discard the evidence, but not at the scene of the crime. Alex was apologising to a couple of the students who hadn't got the opportunity to showcase their work. He didn't need to explain why, and it hadn't escaped Declan that his performance had been by far the longest of the evening. Why didn't someone stop him? He squirmed again, but a few drinks of vodka and lukewarm Coca-Cola in the back seat of an Uber were only minutes away. The negative voices would take a back seat of their own, and he could find some temporary solace.
"Oh, we're all going this way then," he heard Ross announce, through a bellowing, hearty chuckle, seeming to find it genuinely amusing that he'd said goodbye to some of his classmates, only to be heading off in the same direction.
"Fucking wank," Declan whispered, for his own entertainment, furtively stepping onto the pavement, relieved that Ross and the rest were walking in the opposite direction to the shop. He pounded along the road, with his head down, looking forward to trying to erase the past 2 hours from his memory. He entered the shop and grabbed a bottle of Coca-Cola from the fridge and made his way to the counter, studying the different prices of the different sizes of the different bottles of the different spirits, despite knowing exactly what he was going to ask for.
"You know that stuff's no good for you,"
the shopkeeper announced, smiling, the same guy who'd sold him the bottle in his hand.
"Aye," Declan laughed. "I might as well take a quart bottle of vodka as well, then." "Why not, pal? Life is for living, eh?"
the shopkeeper replied, surveying the shelves behind him and repeating,
quarter bottle,
with the emphasis on quarter, implying that he didn't sell many of them. It was a nice enough part of the city, Declan thought, hesitating to specify Glen's vodka, but confident that it would be the only one the shop sold by the 200ml volume.
"That's the only quarter bottles I've got,"
the shopkeeper said, nodding to the bottle that he held with only his index finger and his thumb, the label facing Declan, awaiting his inspection and confirming his premonition.
"Ideal," Declan said, whilst the shopkeeper went for the upsell. "I've got half bottles of Smirnoff and full bottles of some other one, that Grey Goose, I think."
Declan rolled his eyes at the shopkeeper's turned back, wanting out of the shop, fearing the arrival of someone from his class, as he watched him study the labels of the spirits that he stocked, as though it was the first time that he'd ever paid them any attention. It's only for a quick dunt to catch up with whoever's in the pub, mate. An equaliser, Declan thought, telling the shopkeeper. No, that's fine. And holding his debit card out in front of him, waiting to be presented with a machine.
Do you need a bag?
The shopkeeper asked, knowing the answer. But it was something to say whilst they waited on Declan's card processing. Declan shook his head and placed the bottle in his jacket pocket.
That's you, pal. Take care.
Cheers, mate, Declan said, pulling the shop door open with his left hand and reaching into his jacket pocket for his phone with the other. His Uber app confirmed with him that Philippe would be arriving in a Skoda Octavia in 3 minutes, which was sooner than expected, he thought, diving to the side of the shop, substituting his phone for his quarter bottle of Glen's, clicking it open, and pouring a generous measure on top of the tepid Coke that he'd brought to the class. He then opened the fresh bottle, pouring some on the ground and pouring some into the other bottle, to try and take some of the sting out of his potent double, maybe even triple vodka. He filled the fresh Coke bottle with vodka and, noticing there was some left, took a sip from the room temperature bottle to clear space. His head immediately turned warm, and he felt his whole body contract, his mouth and eyes opened as wide as they could, and he let out a liberating wah noise, like he'd just executed a karate move. He ditched the empty quarter bottle into the bin outside the shop, which must have been emptied recently, judging by the satisfying crash of the glass bottle hitting the bottom. He took a quick scan of the main road towards the arts centre, making sure there were no stragglers approaching that he'd have to exchange awkward pleasantries with. He'd have to talk in his class voice too. Fuck that, fucking idiots, he thought, taking another sip, this time from his new Coke bottle, which was chilled, but even stronger than the first. He shook his head again, closing his eyes until the shudder had passed through him. He tightened the lid of both bottles and placed one in each of his jacket's side pockets, taking out his phone to see a message from Philippe saying that he'd arrived. He walked along the pavement a little, in the direction of the art centre, just as he heard a single toot of a horn. He looked over the road and saw the car pulling up and its hazard lights reflecting off the window of a closed estate agent's. Philippe had been a tad premature in confirming his arrival, but it didn't matter. He was out of here. He slid his phone into the front pocket of his jeans before remembering that he should text his mum, who'd probably be expecting him home in about half an hour. He rapidly composed a text, checking through the windscreen as the car pulled away, and then checking Philippe's Google map, displayed on the phone in the corner of his dashboard, making sure they were headed in the right direction to the right location. He let his mum know that the writing class had gone well again, and that he was going out for a drink with a few people from the class. He'd fulfilled the last of his duties for the evening. His class was done, his mum could sleep easy, and he could now step down and surrender himself to the power of alcohol. He knew his mum would like the idea of him hanging about with, well, socialising with, creative types, people who were intelligent and well-to-do. She took comfort in the fact that very few people got beaten up or stabbed in art centres on Tuesday nights, so this was one night she didn't overly worry about her son. His Coke bottle opened with a pop, which made Philippe look into his mirror, smiling. Is that okay? Declan asked, pulling the bottle back from his lips, holding it up for Philippe to see, as though the label provided full disclosure of the contents. Philippe laughed, in polite approval, seemingly aware that his passenger's pre-purchased in-car refreshments contained alcohol, even complimenting the proactive ingenuity when Declan explained that he had to catch up with his mates, who would already be very drunk, in the pub, watching the football. Of course, the driver laughed, as Declan turned to the window, taking the largest gulp yet from one of his bottles. noticing he was already desensitising to the strength. He enjoyed the cooling sensation of the car's window on the side of his forehead, which was now radiating warmth from the vodka. He knew they would pass his house on the way to the pub, and that he could ask Philippe just to drop him home. A sensible suggestion, but one that another sip from the bottle dealt with easily, sending that part of his brain retreating, its hands up in submission, aware that it wouldn't be needed for the rest of the evening, but that it would be putting in a solid shift tomorrow. He knew already what kind of drunk he was going to be. Frustrated, angry and sad. But still, it would feel better than being sober and frustrated, angry and sad. A couple of clicks of his thumbs and a short few minutes' wait. That's how easy it was to go from the art centre to the pub, to go from the creatives, the thespians and the budding artists, to the hard luck stories, the alcoholics and the felons. Declan rolled his eyes, bored at himself and abandoning the process of trying to formulate some sort of metaphor out of this. He looked at his first bottle of Coke, studying it before throwing the rest back in one go, condemning the night to its fate. At least he'd tried, he thought, rewarding himself by taking the first gulp from his second Coke bottle. He could spend his years in the pub now with everyone else who believed that they too had tried. He could join the support networks and drink and discredit the success stories of the area's modest-sized list of alumni who'd made something of themselves. A few professional footballers would get it.
I played against him in an under-16s game. He never got near me. 4-2 we won. I scored a header. Now he's on 20 grand a week.
Then there was James Cavani, actor, writer and director.
His new movie looks shite anyway. He stole 11. I haven't watched his Netflix thing yet, but I've heard I'm not missing much.
Declan had read James Cavani's autobiography and enjoyed his story. It was surreal to see his school spoken about, their local shopping centre, swimming baths and other places that had since closed down, but that he'd heard people go on about. He'd spoken to people who grew up with James Cavani, older guys. Most of them claimed to have been his best pal at some point, but when fame came calling, he ditched them. They spoke as if he owed them something, money or a staggering fall from grace, a return to the pack. Doof Doof had met him though, and he'd tell the story every time James Cavani appeared on the screen when Declan, Connor, Connor's older brother and whoever else were sat in his flat, smoking weed and watching films, or if his name came up in conversation. Doof Doof had about 5 or 6 hits in his set list, but his James Cavani story was one of his favourites. He could be a bit of a fantasist. He was the victim of too many great weekends during his teens and early 20s, but he did have a non-fiction section. Declan was the only one who'd still pay attention, in part because he hadn't known Doof Doof as long as Connor and his older brother, his friend since they'd started primary school in the early 90s, so he felt obliged to be courteous and attentive when he was talking, especially when Declan was a guest in his flat. That Declan enjoyed watching the evolution of Doof Doof's stories also helped, though. He'd always known of Doof Doof, but only as Connor's big brother's pal, the only one who used to be a raver. His onomatopoeic nickname deriving from his penchant for blasting bass-heavy techno music from his flat. Declan had accompanied Connor to his flat a couple of times over the years when they were buying some wheat. Their friend Jordan would come too, before he'd progressed on to cocaine and the scene and the crowd that comes along with it. He developed a borderline alarming habit and was said to have begun selling it in and around the area, Connor had told Declan. Doof Doof had asked about Jordan a few times, sensing that Declan and Connor no longer hung around with him. Declan sensed that Doof Doof had never quite taken to Jordan. Not that he'd ever say anything, though. And he knew firsthand that Jordan saw Doof Doof as a loser or a weirdo or whatever else. Doof Doof, like Declan, was a keen reader, which was a key factor in their ever-strengthening friendship. Declan thought of a night in Doof Doof's house, when Question Time or some other current affairs show had been on, whilst everyone sat, their heads distracted, fearful of checking the time and trying not to contemplate the following day at work or college in Declan's case. Doof Doof had announced to his lethargic late-evening living room that the proletariat needed to remove the adjectives and they'd get the facts. Only Declan understood that he'd meant it as a reference to demagogic politicians and their glib rhetoric, and recognised that he'd paraphrased a quote from To Kill a Mockingbird.
Atticus Finch, Declan had said, nodding,
confusing Connor and Connor's brother even further, and cementing their decision that it was home time. Declan remembered this had earned him a respectful,
"What's your name again, wee man?"
from Doof Doof on the way out. This was always a good feeling as an insecure adolescent, when something you'd said or done had impressed a senior figure enough for them to deem you worthy of a fresh introduction, having previously presumed you to be just another wee dick. James Cavani's appearance was the most exciting thing by quite some distance that had ever happened in Doof Doof's decade-long tenure as a greenskeeper at the local municipal golf course. The component consistent in every telling of the story was that James Cavani had been directing a scene which, to the best of Doof Doof's knowledge, had never featured in anything that he or anyone he'd asked had seen. A local council boss had been liaising with the production crew, and Doof Doof and a couple of his co-workers were briefed that filming would be taking place and that they were to carry on with their jobs as normal. There were a few release forms to be signed, requesting consent, in case any of them made it onto camera. Doof Doof even ironed a fresh council polo shirt for the day and got a haircut especially. If the camera caught him at work, he wanted to look his sharpest, he'd admitted. James Cavani's work tended to be quite edgy, gritty dramas and dark comedies, to use blanket synopsis terminology. He'd acted in a few bigger budget films, but anything he'd written and directed himself had more of an underground feel to it, so the location of the filming made sense. Doof Doof's municipal golf course was a hive of illicit activity, from substance abuse to underage drinking to more serious, violent crimes. The lack of surveillance and the vast woodlands that segregated the fairways along with the access road that ran from the car park below three hostile-looking high-rise flats made it a desirable location for local gangland figures looking to issue reminders of any outstanding payments, or whatever. Doof Doof had found weapons before. A baseball bat that had broken in two in his hands when he'd picked it up, to put it in the bin bag on the back of his buggy. He'd said he'd remembered feeling nauseous, as he imagined how hard the final blow must have landed to have snapped the bat itself. On two other occasions, he'd found ceramic kitchen knives, one of them with a blade he'd said must have been about 12 inches long. After a few hours, Doof Doof had said word must have got out that James Cavani was home and in town filming. A golfer or a dog walker had put it on Facebook or something. Doof Doof said James Cavani had been patient with the small crowd as they trickled across the fairways, congregating at the light rough on the edge of the seventh tee that led into the trees where Doof Doof had found the smaller of the two kitchen knives. It was there that cameras were positioned and a few porta-cabins, trailers, they were maybe known as, but they hadn't looked like the ones you'd hear actors talking about on chat shows or journalists describing when interviewing the stars of an upcoming release. Doof Doof said the porta-cabins were similar in size and design to the ones that you'd give blood in, or the little mobile library that used to come to their local shopping centre every couple of weeks. The lack of luxury didn't bother anyone, not even Cavani, according to Doof Doof, and the set was frantic with energy, with people looking at monitors and making notes, huddled together, confiding. There were makeup artists walking around, revealing who the actors were, as no one out of the entire crew stood out as obvious stars. He didn't recognise anyone from anything that he'd seen before, and neither did the crowd, which meant James Cavani was assigned a solo mission to placate their need for autographs and selfies, and to record videos saying happy birthday and get well soon, or to quote his lines from his more mainstream movie work for the friends and relatives who are his biggest fans and who wouldn't believe this chance encounter. It was all fine, and both parties seemed content from what Doof Doof could observe. And it was only when Cavani and another guy had announced that the scene was to begin rehearsing that one of their production crew had alerted him to a small group of teenagers who'd been hanging around and who'd started filming on their phones. Cavani himself walked over to ask politely if they wouldn't mind putting their phones away. They all agreed that they would, and after posing for a few more photos, he walked back to where he'd been set up to watch the scene, only for one of the wee guys to pull his phone out again, holding it up in the air and facing it, shouting,
"I'm gonna be famous," or "I'm gonna be on the telly," or something.
Doof Doof said James Cavani became a different guy. He slammed his bottle of water down on the grass, and the notes he'd been holding blew everywhere, prompting one of the crew to scramble about trying to gather the individual sheets of what was presumably the script. He started walking back towards the wee guys. Doof Doof said he looked furious, like characters he'd played on screen before. Doof Doof thought he was about to witness the latest celebrity scandal, in real time, live from his work. Movie star James Cavani boots a wee guy up and down a golf course, was Doof Doof's imagined headline. Declan remembered, from the most recent version of his James Cavani story. It had amused Declan, as he contemplated that, in his local vernacular, the word wee could often be a reference to age rather than size. Declan had thought of how to concisely articulate what Doof Doof meant. Somewhere between the teenage years and adulthood is a wee guy phase. Too old to back down from a reprimanding elder, and to be content simply with the thrill of running away, of being chased. But sadly, too young to be jabbed. James Cavani must have reminded himself of this. Doof Doof would tell of how the initial fury in his walk dissipated with every step he took towards them. Just another grown man realizing that he's, ultimately, powerless to resolve a confrontation with obnoxious wee guys. Doof Doof had watched as this predicament registered on James Cavani's face, and he'd walked over himself, with the naive notion that his council polo shirt would carry some authority, and that he could spare Cavani the tense, futile, unwinnable standoff with the defiance of youth, and, most importantly, restore some order to his fairways. Doof Doof said his intervention had only made things turn aggressive, and the smallest of the wee guys started verbally abusing and then threatening him.
"Lanky bastard! Skinny prick!"
The standard stuff. Doof Doof had an appalling diet, though. Maybe even worse than Declan's. Declan put their weight difference down to some genetic injustice as he probably expended as much energy, probably more, unloading lorries and stacking shelves as Doof Doof did during his shifts on the golf course. The smallest and mouthiest wee guy, no doubt unaware that he was conforming to a cliche, had moved from the physical to the socioeconomic and had started taunting Doof Doof about his presumed low income.
"This spike's worth more than you make in a month."
Which was new. A generational thing, maybe, Doof Doof had surmised. It was then that James Cavani told him to fuck off and threatened to throw his bike in the burn. Which rattled the little prick, Doof Doof had said, as though James Cavani had leapt out of a television screen to put him in his place. Doof Doof, who'd confessed to having been starstruck himself, always got passionate at this part of the story. He'd felt humbled that someone as well-known, revered and acclaimed as James Cavani had stood up for him, even if it was only against a wee guy, a wee prick.
"His dad's Eddie Reynolds,"
one of them was shouting. Eddie Reynolds was a serious name, not one anyone used liberally. The folly of youth was at play in this case, and even the apparent Reynolds Jr. shot his pal a cautionary glance before straightening the handlebars of his bike in preparation for their departure. Eddie Reynolds was a notorious gangster, a drug dealer and all the rest of it. A man who headed up his own criminal empire, or as close as the area got to one. everyone in the area had their own stories about Eddie Reynolds. Some were true, and some had been cut and mixed with as much shite as the cocaine and heroin that Reynolds and his associates flooded the streets with.
I'm going to the papers about that!
The one wee guy who had yet to speak shouted, directly to James Cavani. Doof Doof mentioned how this had made all of their faces light up, excited, like this was a more pertinent threat than name-dropping a notorious career criminal.
1 minute you're gangsters, next you're grasses, eh? Get the fuck!
Cavani snapped, before walking back to one of the porta cabins as the wee guys left, shouting and laughing at him, eager to update their social media friends and followers on their afternoon run-in with a celebrity. Doof Doof said Cavani looked gutted. Not even that angry, just despondent. And that he'd felt sorry for him, the way council workers aren't supposed to feel sorry for multimillionaire celebrities. Only Doof Doof and the crew member of Cavani's had been close enough to hear the entire exchange. So the crowd were confused, but aware something had gone on. A few of them shouted encouragement, and some were disappointed not to be seeing a scene getting filmed. They hadn't paid for or been promised anything, but felt short-changed and let down. A guy who'd got a selfie shouted to Cavani that he'd acted like a diva and told him to remember where he came from. Doof Doof confessed that if he hadn't witnessed the entire episode, he'd also have assumed the narrative of the big-time film star, having a petulant hissy fit with local kids from the area he grew up in. But this was a lesson, he supposed. Doof Doof told of how a few of the crowd stuck around, a few left, and a few new faces arrived. He continued with his work, altering pin positions, cutting grass, raking bunkers. But he'd kept looking over at what still looked like a set to see if anything would be filmed. After about an hour, Doof Doof noticed a guy who was with the film crew approaching his buggy, which prompted him to take 3 or 4 rapid draws of his joint before flicking it into the long grass behind him and stepping onto the fairway to meet him. The guy told him that James Cavani would like to speak to him when he had a minute. This was a sentence Doof Doof never expected to hear in his life. Doof Doof had jokingly nodded at his buggy, asking if the guy wanted a lift. He smiled, and they walked back towards the set. He admitted that he'd felt paranoid that he was stinking of cannabis, but he knew that James Cavani was supposed to be a bit mental and that he wouldn't mind. When they got to the set, Cavani was leaning against a table and blowing into a polystyrene cup, trying to cool its contents, and laughing and joking with 2 guys who were sitting on 2 camping chairs, eating. He had a new energy about him and seemed to have composed himself. And when he saw Doof Doof, he carefully sat his cup down on the grass and put his hand out.
Mate, I just want to say thanks for earlier and sorry if I was bit off. This thing is sending me fucking bonkers. I'm James. What's your name?
Doof Doof said he'd felt nervous. He'd never even seen anyone famous in the flesh until this day, which was why he had hesitated between the formal and the informal, between Raymond and Doof Doof. But he decided it would be respectful to give his real name, and it would spare him having to tell the story of how he used to be a bit of a raver. He was far enough out of his comfort zone, and the half-joint he'd just smoked hadn't done him any favours, so being put on the spot and having to explain the origins of his nickname was the last thing he needed. He explained that Cavani had an aura, but he was also disarming, and as they began talking, Doof Doof wanted to correct him every time he'd said Raymond. It seemed unnatural, and it made him think of his late mum or his bosses or the police or any other authority figures. Doof Doof commented that the only thing that stood out about Cavani was how healthy he looked. This was to be expected. Women loved him. He was in his mid-40s, but he looked like he'd only been a couple of years above Declan at school. He had tan skin, dark hair, and a sharp, well-defined jawline. His Italian roots providing strong insurance against his West of Scotland upbringing.
Not much changes about here, eh? Eddie Reynolds. His son seems a lovely wee guy.
Doof Doof had laughed and said, "Tell me about it," or something like that. Something he'd never said before, admitting that he'd felt like a dick as soon as the words left his mouth, as though he was trying to get into the character of Raymond. Declan always enjoyed Doof Doof's self-deprecation, and he continued on the theme, confessing that he'd said, "Do you know him?" As though Eddie Reynolds was a big name himself. Of all the A-listers to ask James Cavani if he knew he'd asked about a local crook. Cavani didn't mind, though. He was probably enjoying the break from conversations about show business, Doof Doof figured. "Same school, same classes. He went out with my sister for a while. Dumping him was the only smart decision she ever made." Cavani had laughed, adding, "He wanted me to write a film about his life. They love all that." Doof Doof had nodded, struggling to think of what to say, but he'd been relieved that his question was being answered and not ridiculed. Cavani had taken a cautious sip of his coffee before continuing.
"How the fuck do you pitch that? Well, it's like Goodfellas, but it's a Scottish remake. As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a bit of a dodgy cunt. Scottish Goodfellas, write that down. BBC Scotland will be well up for it."
Cavani had laughed again, shouting across to the guy who'd come over to meet Doof Doof. It was true, though, Declan thought to himself, lifting his head off the window of Philippe's car, noticing that they were approaching the street where James Cavani grew up, that for all the great movies and series made about organised crime and gangsters, when it was real life and close to home, and the carefully curated charm of the paradoxical characters and the glamour and appeal of the lifestyle were stripped away, it was depressing and fucking boring. Declan thought of Jordan and how he'd apparently got himself involved with these sorts of people, albeit the lower echelons. He'd always been impressionable and loved anyone who was popular, for whatever reason, and he'd do anything to hang around with them. Connor had recently sent Declan a video of Jordan slapping himself in the face in someone's living room as an older crowd shouted for him to put more force into it, finding it hysterical. Declan and Connor hadn't told Jordan that they had seen the video and that they'd found it alarming and sad above all. As much as Jordan was turning into a dickhead, he was still, in theory, their friend. And it was sad to see videos of anyone being degraded like that. They figured he would have mentioned it first, seeing as it was widely circulated. But he never did. His pride probably wouldn't let him. He saw Declan and Connor as beneath him now anyway, and the last people he'd want to concede his vulnerability to. Declan and Jordan had known each other since they were toddlers, their mothers being close friends. But Declan had felt them growing apart for a while now. All they had in common was the past. If they'd only just met now, at 24 years old, then they probably wouldn't have become friends, Declan had hypothesised, and made peace with this inevitable part of life. People change, and you change. Doof Doof always wrapped up his James Cavani story by telling of how Cavani had told him to help himself to the spread that the catering team had put out for the crew's lunch. Doof Doof initially declined, he said, his manners overruling his appetite. But Cavani insisted, commenting on the smell of cannabis and laughing and telling him to try a donut, that it would all be going to waste anyway. He told Doof Doof they were going to go again and try and get the scene done and asked if he wanted to be in it. Doof Doof declined, horrified at the prospect of seeing himself on screen, regardless of his new haircut and fresh polo shirt. They shook hands. "Nice to meet you, Raymond, and cheers for having her back over there earlier." Doof Doof told him he didn't want to bother him for a photo, as a way of asking him for a photo, and one of the crew took one of them together, after an initial struggle with operating the camera on Doof Doof's relic of a phone. A phone that had only recently been put out of its misery, the photo of Doof Doof and James Cavani along with it. It had stuck with Doof Doof, and subsequently Declan, who knew the story verbatim, how normal Cavani had been. how he was authentic, a human being. His parents had passed away, and the only family connection he had to the place was his younger sister, Siobhan, who was a recovering heroin addict and had lived in their childhood home until recently. She'd been seen around the shopping centre a few times, Doof Doof said, so she couldn't have moved too far away. James Cavani didn't mention her much in his book, Declan noticed, but everyone in the town knew about her, and Declan had seen her around. Siobhan Cavani had been a few years above Doof Doof at high school, and by his and several other accounts, she'd been incredibly good-looking. Everyone fancied her. And if it had been an American high school, like in a movie, Doof Doof had once explained, she'd have been the undisputed prom queen. Despite all her troubles and how her life had turned out, Doof Doof said that hearing her full name still brought back the nostalgic connotations of his youth and the feeling of first realising that you fancied someone, his first crush, as he put it, unsure if the kids still said that now. Cavani had a house in Glasgow, but he'd stated before that he preferred the relative anonymity of living in London and occasionally New York, cities where people were too caught up in their own thing to care about anyone else. The one certain truth Declan took from the autobiography and from Doof Doof's and other locally sourced James Cavani stories was that it sounded shite to be famous. At least when it began to interfere with the work that made you famous in the first place. But away from all of that side, what inspired Declan and drew him to the world of creative writing was how incredible Cavani made it sound to be able to turn your own ideas, thoughts, experiences and your fears and neuroses into content that so many people enjoyed and connected with. Declan thought of the fulfillment of seeing something you'd once scribbled down on a scrap bit of paper or a bus or train ticket become the basis of an award-winning film, or to have millions of people watch the finale of a drama series that had brought you close to insanity with writer's block, before the answer came to you in the shower and you manically used your finger to write the buzzwords in the condensation of the bathroom mirror, petrified of the solution tormenting you further by not hanging around in your mind long enough for the appropriate stationery to be procured. He remembered finding Cavani's stories like these in the autobiography nothing short of exhilarating. And it was in these moments that Cavani said he came alive. Chasing those feelings of fulfillment and escapism was, Declan figured, what made him so prolific and devoted to his work. Declan had tried, and it wasn't for him.
"Thanks, mate," he announced to Philippe as he stepped onto the pavement. "It was nice to meet you," he added, leaning back inside the car with his thumb in the air, as though their initial good-natured conversation had been sustained for the duration of the journey.
He felt a buzzing sound in his ears, and his eyes squinted as the glow from the vodka was introduced to the fresh evening air. The streetlights and the neon sign from the sunbed salon opposite the pub. There was still time to abandon his plan. He could still walk home and grab something from one of the takeaways en route. He looked at the pub again, trying to gauge how busy it was, watching as the bar door opened and a man with a cigarette in his mouth stepped outside onto the pavement, playing with his phone before feeling around his tracksuit pockets for a lighter.
"Fuck it,"
he whispered, hearing the sound of the back door of Philippe's Skoda Octavia slam shut as he crossed the road. Back to the life that wouldn't be going anywhere, that would always be there waiting for him. To the life he'd thought he could have done better than. The voice in his head sneered. A defiant reminder that it needed more than a quarter bottle of vodka to be silenced, especially after tonight. Especially after everything. His strides towards the pub lengthened, and he opened the door to the sound of an advert playing on the televisions, confirming that the football had finished and that he was here with the sole intention of obliterating the evening from his mind, along with all the, by now familiar, feelings of being totally fucking lost which it had evoked, and the fresh feelings of hopelessness too, now that his writing dream, or whatever it had been, had taken a bullet straight to the head. He'd given these feelings and the voice that spoke to him on their behalf.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.